Your host, Justin Konikow. Today, we are going to get right into it with my man, Kyle Henry. Kyle is a very interesting cat. He jumped into the real estate industry in his first 8 months, has absolutely crushed it, but it's his background, which is one of the reasons why he's having such great success. And he takes something that scares so many people in sales, and that is picking up the phone, and turns it into real business. So we're going to dig into his strategies, how he does it. We're going to give you all the goods in this episode, and we're going to dig into his story and how he got here. Now, I do want to say, when people hear the word cold calling, their backs go up, right? They think somebody's just going to pump out the numbers and call me, and you know, I'm going to get hung up on, and all these negative connotations about scripting and all these things, right? We're going to bust all those myths because he does it with empathy. He's probably one of the most caring guys I've ever met, and he brings value. So if you're a consumer watching this, you're definitely going to want to stick around and watch this episode because he's an indication of the person that you want to be working with that isn't just trying to be the greasy old salesman and try and sell you something with every single phone call. He's all about building relationships. If you're on the stream, I want you to tell me where you're from. We can actually watch all the chats. We're live on Facebook, we're YouTube, we're LinkedIn. YouTube is the primary platform that we're hosting all of these expert interviews on. We do it every single Thursday from 2 to 3 p.m. And this is for the people, by the people. We watch the analytics. We listen to your recommendation. We bring on the guests. As you saw in the intro, Ryan Surant, Scott McGillivray, Salerno, Zillow Killer. I mean, Giselle, there's so many amazing people that have poured into us in past episodes. So please go ahead and look at the past episodes and let us know which ones you like the most. Let us know what type of topics you want covered as well. We're doing this one specifically because it was in very, very high demand by the audience. And I think it's going to bring a ton of value. John Papaloni from Mississauga Signature. Nice to see you, brother. I see you on so many of the channels and definitely appreciate you having you here. So let's bring on Kyle and let's jump right into it. My man, Kyle Henry. Look at that. How are you doing, brother?
I'm good. How are you, man?
Good. I recognize that beautiful office. It looks like quite the space. So you taking over the Prime Empire or what?
Oh, I don't know about that, but definitely still in the office for the hour. That's for sure.
That's awesome. So let's jump right into it. Let's give them the goods to start with, and then we'll dig into your backstory and kind of where a lot of this came from. But what are your thoughts about the real estate industry and how cold calling applies to it today?
I mean, to be honest with you, I think it's more prevalent than it's ever been. I think that, you know, to build the relationship, to introduce yourself, you have to pick the phone up and make that connection. Social media does a really good job of making the call a little bit more warmer for you, but you do, I think, still need to make that call no matter what. I think that's kind of my two cents.
Yeah, and I was talking to a client about this about an hour ago. Actually, I was at Grogan Ford, and we were hanging out. I was talking about his new Bronco. It started off with that, but this guy actually operates one of the largest retail outlets in North America, and he was saying how, you know, a lot of people do use social media as a crutch. They use email as a crutch, right? They're using it to make them feel like they're doing something, but they won't pick up the phone. There's just this massive fear that they have of just answering the phone. And how many agents are watching this or people that run sales businesses, when their phone rings, they get anxiety and they don't pick up the call. Yet picking up the call opens the door to so many opportunities. So if you were going to talk directly to that person, what would you tell them to maybe get rid of the fear of picking up the phone?
For sure. So I think, you know what, like that's probably the most common objection to cold calling is, you know, you're qualifying yourself out of making the call or picking the phone call up. So either you think it's not a good time for the call, you think, you know, they're having dinner, they just worked all day, they don't want to hear from me, it's a bad time. All of these reasons are reasons to not pick the phone up. And I think everybody, myself included, sometimes I tell myself that too. You got to remind yourself, hey, if they don't pick up, I'm just going to leave a voicemail and they'll call me back when it's a good time, right? So it's just about changing your mindset and making, you know, that scary thing into more of a fun task.
For sure. And I mean, not all calls are easy, right? Sometimes, especially in this business, you're making tough calls about delays and things that happen and you're transmitting information. But do you find that sometimes the agents take on the burden as if it's their fault? Like say there's a construction delay or delay with paperwork that the agents are like, oh, I don't want to call them because they're going to yell at me, right? Do you think that's part of the problem?
Happens all the time. It happened to me earlier today, actually, because I had to make one of those phone calls where I was pushing a date back. And it's always uncomfortable, right? Because, you know, it's natural though. You're going to make an emotional connection to the buyers that you're working with, and you're going to take on a lot of that responsibility, even though none of it is your responsibility. But you know what? It's just about being open and honest. And in my opinion, being transparent, because transparency builds trust, and you just tell them what's going on. And hey, these are the cards that we've been dealt with, but here's the solution, or this is what we're going to do forward for you. you know, kind of good news sandwiched him a little bit. But
so you plan, so you touch on something interesting, right? Like you're planning to make the call with a solution. So let's extrapolate that. So you have a client and you have somebody closing on a property. So you have two clients in the transaction. One is trying to provide the asset and it, there's maybe a delay in the closing and the client obviously has a lot of moving parts on their side. Yep. How are you serving the client who's maybe building the product, and how are you serving the client that is closing on the product when you're approaching a call like that?
Yeah, for sure. So my responsibility to the person who's building the property is to take on all of that burden off of their plate so that they can focus on what they want to do and what's more important to them. Let me handle the conversation, the paperwork, and the transactional side of things, and I'll take that off your plate. So that's where I do, that's what I do with them. For the buyer side of things though, we're moving their date back. They've already sold their house. You know, they've got this period of limbo that they're sure. in. Find a house. So my solution to them was, hey, let me actually help you find a short-term solution in the interim. I'll make those phone calls for you. It's a little bit more work on my plate, but it's more value to them. And I look at it as a business, not just a transaction. So they've already sent me two referrals for the same project, even though we've pushed their date back.
For sure. And there's a lesson to everybody watching, right? Like you build narratives in your mind that these people are going to hate you and it's your fault. It's not your fault. And the longer you wait to make those phone calls, the worse off it's going to be. I think everybody's human and they appreciate transparency. I think, you know, that's one thing that we were talking about this morning. Hugh and I were in a meeting with a developer and we were having that discussion around projects and how, you know, he's not interested in a sales-based or transaction-based relationship. He's interested in a long-term relationship that, you know, we're obviously going to have speed bumps. It's not always going to be smooth, but it's how you operate within the tough times that are going to stipulate, you know, if you get the good opportunities, correct?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, interesting. So let's walk through a 60-second game. So I want everybody to see what this looks like. So 60-second game is a concept we got from one of my mentors, Mr. Ryan Serhan. Shout out to Ryan and the whole team at the Serhan House. They're unbelievable. Doing big work. Shout out to Raf and everybody out there. 60-second game goes like this. Ryan has an acting background. It's based off improv. So you say 60-second game at any point in time with a friend of yours. So Kyle and I do this in the office. We'll say 60-second game. You throw down a scenario and then you walk through that conversation, right? The reason that we do it is practice makes perfect. I look at it very similarly to how I look at jujitsu or martial arts or working out or doing things that maybe I'm not that great at. You do it so that when it's time to represent your clients, be it sellers or buyers, you're in the best position for success. So if you're a consumer watching this, you're going to have some fun seeing kind of how we go about doing it. If you're an agent, I encourage you to put this in your repertoire every single day. We host a room on Clubhouse every Wednesday, I think at 1 o'clock. We may shift that date so we don't conflict with other rooms. We do 30 minutes and we just throw down scenarios so that we're in the best position for success. So 60-second game. Kyle, do you want to pick the scenario?
No, you pick it. I'll go.
All right. So let's go with that same conversation. Let's walk through you pushing my date back. So I'm a buyer. I've sold my house. I've made a crazy amount of money because I sold it before my property closed and I got to close about a week or two later. So ring, ring.
Hey, Justin.
Hey, Kyle. I just got your email. So you said you wanted to hop on a quick phone call?
Yeah, I just wanted to connect with you and say, I'll be honest with you, it's not with the greatest of news, but don't worry. At the end of this, I'm going to have a solution for you. I was talking to the builder regarding your property that you purchased in XYZ town.
Okay.
And they've unfortunately ran into a little bit of a construction delay. We're going to have to move your closing date from Monday of next week to the following Monday.
Oh man, I had movers booked on Monday. I mean, another delay. Like, man, it seems like there's always construction delays. Like, what is happening?
I totally understand where you're coming from. And trust me, I'm frustrated for you. I understand where you're coming from because, you know, it's a lot of things that you've got to reschedule. But what's happening right now with COVID is that things are backlogged like you wouldn't believe from a supply chain perspective. Things like kitchens, doors, everything seems to be backordered because there was a lack of employment last year, which caused supply chain bottlenecks to happen. And now we're seeing them on the back end with respect to deliveries and timelines. Now, I know that this is unfortunate news for you. Now, what I'm going to do is I've already contacted a number of people to talk about short-term rental options for you in the interim because you had planned on moving this upcoming Monday. And I have options for you. Here are the three of them for you. But look, do any of these fit what you're looking for a seven-day period?
They all do. You're amazing, Kyle. I'm going to call my wife. Thank you so much and send you two more referrals.
Oh, thank you.
So everybody, that was kind of how you do it, right? You typically want to go about 60 seconds. Sometimes we let it go longer just so we can kind of practice through it. We'll probably do it a couple more times during the session. So you're welcome to hang out. Post in the comments if you have any scenarios you actually want us to go through. I would love to see some comments about, you know, hey guys, role play this scenario. Because this is truthfully how you actually get better at this. One thing, couple things I'm going to point out as Kyle was doing that is, you know, he had the solutions ready, right? So just making a call willy-nilly and just flying by the seat of your pants, probably not ideal. Kyle, extrapolate that, right? Because some people try and cold call and just fake it, or they use the same scripts on everybody and you can smell it on them. Yeah. How do you differentiate yourself?
So I don't believe in scripts, first and foremost. I'm just going to wipe that. I think that you should have, absolutely, you should have a structure to your call, something that you follow every single time you pick the phone up. But having a script can sometimes handcuff you in the situation, because if they say something that you haven't planned for, now you're going to start to say a lot of ums, you're going to get fed, or you're going to get hung up on yourself, and it's not going to look good on their end. They're going to be able to tell that you're reading off of a piece of paper. So I try and keep it a little bit fluid, but before the call, especially for something similar to this scenario we just ran through, it's important to have your solutions lined up. It's important to kind of anticipate some of the questions and frustration that are going to come back at you. Even though it's not your responsibility, you are the messenger, and you're going to be able, the one having to brunt those conversations. So take 10 minutes, maybe do a quick Google search to see what kind of options there are for solutions, but also be able to educate them on what's going on rather than just saying, hey, we have to do this, see you later.
So a little bit of interesting facts about Kyle. He used to be a wrestler. So his background is clearly hard work and then countering moves with moves and being prepared, right? So understanding the sequence of events that may happen in a wrestling match, it seems to be translating to real estate fairly well for you.
Oh, well, I'm trying to make that look, like, give that kind of perception.
Yeah. Is it hard though? Like, do you find the job difficult at all?
There are aspects of the job that are difficult, but I think that the previous job that I was at really actually prepared me really, really well for this industry and this environment. Obviously we're selling two different products, mm-hmm. but you know, sales is sales regarding whether you're selling a pen or you're selling a house, right?
So. Yeah. And I want people to understand that. That's why we host this on this channel. Is I don't care if you own a sneaker company, you own a coffee shop, a gym, a real estate brokerage, or you own Amazon.ca. I think understanding the sales and marketing process and the different components of it is integral, right? And doing the work and training yourself is everything. And everybody I respect that run good ethical businesses really put in the work. You know, let's dig into that for a second. So your previous job, what was it and how did it translate to the real estate industry?
So I worked at a large recruiting and staffing company. It was North America wide. And I was a sales manager there for a number of years. And what my role was recruitment and management of my recruiters on my team. But portion of that was B2B sales and trying to go out and solicit these organizations to use our services. So recruiting for all of their positions. So that was a large part of my job, was, you know, picking up the phone call every single day. And B2B sales, in my opinion, is one of the hardest things to do, because you're working your way up an organizational chart where people just have no regard or talking about, and then you just get flung to the next person. So
they don't care, right? Because you're talking to gatekeepers more than you're talking to the decision makers.
Totally.
So how do you get to the decision makers? Let me ask you that.
Repeat, like, just persistence, repetition. Even though, you know, I'm calling, say, John Smith, who has no ifs, ands, or buts what happens with recruitment, I'm calling him to learn about the organization, find out what's more important to his role, so that when I go to the supervisor, for example, I can bring that value from kind of the base level up and say, hey, this is what, you know, the rumblings are. Here's my solution for you.
So as you're working through your cold calling in this previous organization, you're actually identifying problems in the business, not related to necessarily your end that solution to the owner.
100%. And that's the same thing that I do in this industry is, hey, what's the biggest pain is what I call it, or problem that is it tough competing market? Is it your budget? Is it whatever it is? What value can I bring to you as the consumer so that I can actually be of service rather than just transactional?
And what are you seeing consumers encountering as maybe their biggest problems in today's markets?
Definitely supply right now. Supply is, of course, a record low. But I do a lot of new construction as well. And construction prices have gone up. So price has been a real concern for people, right? So it's just about educating them and adding the value, showcasing maybe it's the fishes that you get right out of the gate that's the value add that they don't know about or what have you. But it's all about understanding their problem or pain. If you don't know what it is, you're never going to bring the right value to the table. And then you're just going to be a shotgun salesman is what I call it, where you're just selling everything and everything under the sun because you don't know what the problem is.
Yeah, and I think that's a problem in our industry, and the consumers can smell it, right? Like when I do get called from people that are in the sales game, I always want to hear what they have to say. And the second I feel like it's a script, I just turn off, right? I send an email back to somebody today to take me off their list. And I may have engaged their services if they were identifying maybe what my problems were or thinking about me versus the sales process. And that's really switched in, I'd say, the last 20 to 30 years, because I mean, if people watch Boiler Room and movies like that, it wasn't like that always, right? Like we are coming into a new age of sales. Don't you agree?
100%. Consumers are just smarter, have the access to the information. So we can't, you know, we can't be a snake oil salesman. Not that anybody would want to be, but you can't do that anymore.
Yeah, I was in a room this morning talking with some interesting folks, massive YouTubers and people that have voices online. We were talking about how it's all about the search for truth, right? The truth in all things, the truth in the work you do, building communities and extrapolating that to a higher level. And, you know, being in conversations like this, you know, albeit we have a good audience of people here too, this is going to live on an evergreen for who knows how many years and who knows how many people it does reach over the next years. And if you're going to give messages to salespeople that are out there that are picking up the phone and calling, what message would you give them in terms of where the future of sales is going?
It's a good question. I mean, the future of sales, because I think I'm only going to speak to our industry because I can't speak to retail because, you know, Amazon, for example, are taking over. But I think that the nature of sales in general is always going to be a people business. I mean, people like the convenience of shopping on Amazon for smaller purchases. When you're talking about real estate, I don't think that's going to be sort of a click and buy kind of industry. So I do think that, you know, you need to be a people person. You need to learn how to communicate, and you need that persistence for sales, because it's, you know, it takes me 100 calls to get a few appointments, right? So if you're not going to make those calls, sometimes you got to, it's a scale of justice, right? Do I want to be a high performer? Do I want to, you know, just run of the mill average kind of person, which is totally fine too, right? So.
Yeah. And like, what's your net, right? Because if I'm buying a product on Amazon, typically I'm buying something that the retail purchase or the relationship purchase isn't going to bring me any more value. Like, I just need it here now. I don't really care about, you know, whether it was handcrafted by Uncle Jimmy down the street and what that story was. But at the same time, like Eco Surf Shop in Goderich, right? I'm going up there to McDonald Lane to do an open house later today, pop in with Iris, do all that jazz. I mean, I stop in that surf shop every time I'm there. I've been doing that for years. Those people, I could order their products online. They're fun to talk to. They wrote a really cool surf shop. They have a bike shop in the back. They just have axe throwing. They just opened up a shop in Grand Bend. We happened to work with them on that deal because of the relationship building, right? And talking about the future of sales, I think people are going to get more clear and concise of, you know, do I want to interact with people that are building my community, or do I want to interact with, you know, a company that all they care about is efficiency and profit, right? And I think those are two very, very different things.
I agree 100%. And that's the future of sales, is the relationship. Right? Because now you are now a long-term customer of that company because of the relationship, right? Even though they make a wicked product, I'm there for the relationship. And that's going, and it's always been there, but I think it's going to be social media kind of, in my opinion, kind of put that a little bit on the back burner, because now I can interact with people on my phone. Yeah. But COVID, I think, woke people up that I really miss interacting with people. So I think that that's coming back pretty heavy.
Well, to curtail that conversation I spoke about earlier about how people hide behind social media, the crux of that conversation at the end was, I was on the phone with our boy Andy T this afternoon. Amazing guy. I mean, probably the top broker in all of North America, honestly, if you look at the production rates that he's putting out. And the whole premise of that conversation was, picking up the phone is the most important thing he does. Yeah. Right? The social media, the marketing, the digital, the print, and everything else, it all matters, right? All of it matters. And I'm a heavy digital guy, right? Like, we own the production company. We do a lot of social, and it impacts our business in a serious way. But actually being able to pick up the phone and close deals and negotiate is what our clients pay us for. But I think people are just so scared to do that. Now, to throw a wrench into this conversation, 60-second game, I'm a Facebook lead. And then we'll talk about Facebook leads after. So I have filled out a form that you put on one of your new listings. So you call me and let's have a quick 60-second game about you converting me to either a qualified buyer that you're gonna show the property to, or the conversation goes sideways and we don't work together. Let's see how it goes.
Ring, ring.
Hello?
Hey, is this Justin?
Yes.
Hey, Justin, it's Kyle from Prime Real Estate. How are you today?
I'm good. Why are you calling me?
Yeah, no, I totally get it. I sort of just throw myself into your calendar like this. I'm actually calling because I saw that you registered couple of hours ago for one of my new listings, 123 Any Street.
Oh, okay.
You remember You remember clicking something like that on Facebook?
I click a lot of things on Facebook.
Yeah, I do the exact same thing. Then I have random people calling me and sending me things on email, and it's just sometimes a pain. But I wanted to reach out because I do think that this is a really, really awesome property. And I would love to just introduce myself and answer any questions you have. Are you looking at real estate at all right now?
Well, yeah. I mean, I clicked on your ad. So yeah, I'm clearly looking at real estate.
Yeah, but are you looking to buy something or is it more just of a browsing kind of thing?
You know what? Yeah. I mean, I've been looking for a little while. You know, I don't always trust agents because I feel like they're just going to try and sell me something. But yeah, your property looked really interesting. Which one was it?
So that was the bungalow on 123 Any Street in London.
Oh, yeah, yeah. There's a really cool park right around the corner from there that I go to.
That's right. Okay, perfect. So, okay. So are you from that area right now?
No, I'm not. I've always kept an eye on it, but I always thought it was kind of out of my reach and price point wise.
Okay. Yeah, no, I understand. So let me ask you this. You've been searching for a little while. What exactly is it you're looking for if you were to buy something, for example, today?
I don't need much. I mean, it's just me. I work a lot. You know, I'd like to have a little bit of a backyard, somewhere for my motorcycle and somewhere to do my underwater basket weaving. But yeah,
that's pretty cool. I'd like to talk to you a little bit more about that. But let me ask you this. So this property is about 1500 square feet. It is a bungalow with a detached garage and a pretty killer backyard. Does that kind of sound something that you're looking for?
Yeah. It sounds pretty manageable.
Okay. I mean, if you would be interested, I'd love to even just take you through it. You don't have to buy anything. You never have to talk to me again, but I'd love to at least show you this property to see if it's what you're looking for and if it fits all the boxes.
Okay. I'll call you back.
Yeah, that sounds good. If I don't hear from you, can I call you on Friday?
Yeah, that works.
Amazing. Thanks so much, Justin.
Okay, perfect. Well, everybody, Kyle did a pretty good job converting me. He gave me some facts about the property that I didn't know. Facebook leads are notorious for filling out forms and they give you a really hard time, which I don't understand. Like they fill out the form with their name and their contact information. I get it from a consumer's perspective. Agents don't typically put prices and they get really frustrated. The reason I can tell you if you're a consumer is prices change all the time. So if they're running these campaigns and these ads on the economies of scale, it is very difficult to be just keeping them up to date. And if you put a wrong price, then they're upset about the price being incorrect. I also know a lot of agents do it because they're just trying to do the lead capture and the scripting and everything. Not really how we do it. The way I've watched Kyle do it is he provides the information, tries to match the property up with the right person, or see if they're a fit to work together. Because Kyle has a specific type of expertise. And as a consumer, you want somebody that's an expert. But I would also behoove any agents out there that are making these calls to not just work with anybody for the sake of it. So if you talk to somebody and you find out that maybe I'm looking for a product that doesn't match me, what would you do with that client? Like if they were looking for, say, a condo, what would you do with that client?
So I don't really do a lot of condo sales or purchases, to be honest with you. So we work with somebody condo expert. So personally, I would introduce him to that individual named Victor Addis. He's a condo king because he's probably better suited to help out that person than I am. I really can barely find out where the date is on a status certificate. So I would definitely put that over Victor for sure.
Trying to pull Vic into the chat. I just sent it to the group chat right now just to see if we can get these guys in here. But yeah, the reason I asked that question was that specific reason, right? Is Vic actually said it yesterday. One of the superpowers, I think, at Prime, this isn't a pitch for Prime at all, but it is how we think, is put it in the hands of the right person in the geographic area that's an expert in the product type. So if you're a consumer watching again or an agent, make sure you're working with somebody that knows the area they're actually working in and that product type because it can be really scary. We were in a clubhouse room this morning and agents were talking about how they don't have access to all the information that's out there on boards they're not a part of, yet they're calling listing agents to say, hey, what are the comps? And the listing agents are literally laughing saying, here are the comps and sending the highest priced comps in the area. So consumers need to be very well aware of what's happening behind the scenes. This is why we do this series, is we are trying to pull back the curtain on all things real estate media and marketing. Now, Kyle, how long have you been in the industry? Like how long have you actually been a licensed agent?
16 months.
Do you know how many deals you've done?
52.
There you go. He knows his numbers, folks. So 52 is a lot for that period of time. What do you think is one of your reasons for success?
I don't like talking about myself, but it's probably that I answer the phone when I probably shouldn't answer the phone. So if a call comes in at any time of the day, I'll phone up. That's probably it.
I'm asking these leading questions for a reason. We're not a brokerage that really talks about production that often. It's the first time I've ever asked him that publicly. It's just to give everybody context of if Kyle can do it, so new in the industry, you can do it as well. What are your methodologies though of cold calling? Like how do you actually jump in and schedule it in your day? What does that actually look like?
So cold calling is set up twice in my day. So I set up my calendar so there's no white space in it. So there's always something to do if I had a free day of no appointments, for example. There's always something that I can be doing, whether it's cold calling, paperwork, admin, anything. So cold calling is set up in my calendar from 10:30 to 12 every day, and then from 1:30 to 3:30 every day. So if I don't have appointments during that time, I should be picking up the phone and calling people, whether they're past clients, leads, what have you. So that's how I structure my day, and that's from Monday to Friday. So every day, two sessions of cold calling is in my day, and that's how I can kind of make the phone call volume numbers that I can in a week.
And that's how, when we work with our partners, we can tell them that we're banging out 500 calls or 250 calls whenever. We just got to get something done, right? And I think that's my favorite thing about just the world we live in now, is that ability to kind of leverage and balance out the skill sets that different people have. Because quite frankly, like, I don't love cold calling. So you partner with people that love cold calling, so they've got that ability. But I think this is such an interesting conversation because you've impacted me and helped my skill set as we do the 60-second games and we go throughout our daily lives to pick up the phone more and call people more and put systems in place so I can be making more phone calls. But definitely important. So Adnan is in the chat. He said it's straight fire. I'm assuming the whole thing is straight fire that he's talking about. And then my boy Jeremy McCall, thanks for joining us, Jeremy. Jeremy's one of my most longstanding friends. He used to work at Barney's back in the day. He is a local legend and does some pretty cool stuff in the nonprofit. Well, also runs Dad Club London, one of the largest dad club organizations in London. So if you're a dad, go check that place out as well. So Kyle, what do you do to keep your skill set sharp when it comes to cold calling?
I role play and practice every single day. Whether I do my elevator pitch when I'm driving to the office, which sounds ridiculous because I'm just driving in my vehicle by myself. Pitching myself.
Yeah.
But I think it's really important to sharpen your sword like that, right? Because it's kind of like cardio, in my opinion. You know, if you stop running for a week, you've lost all of your cardio. And then the next time you go for a run, your lungs feel like you're on fire. The exact same thing with sales. You can lose it over the course of a weekend if you're not kind of just practicing. And you don't have to say it like you're talking to somebody, but just go through it so you're audibly ready. That's one of the biggest things because, you know, everybody's done this where you come back to work on Monday morning, you haven't talked to workers in forever. 3 days and you don't know what to say and you don't know how to say it and you stumble on your words. It's the exact same thing. So I practice every single day. And then I just, you know, I tell myself that the call is going to be easy. Just me introducing myself. And if they hang up on me, I got another one to make.
That's amazing. So what do you do prep wise? Like, do you have a little sequence you do before you actually make that first call?
Nothing crazy. I look at so I have a page that I look at that just kind of goes through some regular rebuttals that I get. There's probably 15 rebuttals that I typically will get.
Well, this is interesting. So name me like two or three of those rebuttals. I'd love to hear them.
Send me a proposal or send me something in an email. And I don't have time right now.
Okay. How do you answer I don't have time right now?
Hey, I totally get it. I threw myself into your calendar without an appointment.
Did that to me. That's amazing.
It's the one I use every time because it just comes out of my mouth because I practice it. But
yeah,
I threw myself into your calendar without an appointment. What day and time works best for you? How is Friday at 2 p.m.? No, that doesn't work. Okay, well, how about Saturday at 10? You just
And they're trying to close the door and you're just leaving it open to a conversation down the road too, right?
Totally. I'm just throwing my foot before it actually shuts. 100%. Yeah. I'm just trying to move the needle a little bit. And I'm like, not every deal is going to close, but until I know for sure, I don't want that door to close because maybe I didn't give them the right value. So let's hop on a quick call and figure each other out.
So over 50 deals in your first month in real estate, or first 8 months in real estate, what do you find has helped you keep that safe foot in the door and not come across as a greasy salesman, right? Because I know a lot of those deals are follow-ups that probably wouldn't close unless you followed up 2, 3, 4, 5 times, right? Like, it is the multiple follow-up that gets it.
Yeah, that's right. So I truly believe in trying to shorten any sales cycle as much as possible, right? Because in real estate, sometimes it can be a 6 to 12 month sales cycle. So I try and control as much as I can control because 90% of this industry is, I have no control over. So I just try and keep that conversation prevalent and always top of mind. So if we leave a conversation where it's not the right time, no problem. I totally get it. I'm never going to pressure you, but how about I give you a call in, 30 days, I'll put it in calendar. And now they know I'm going to call them because I've put them in calendar. It's going to show up on their email and it's sure. Just friendly conversation. Friendly. If they're not ready, they're not ready, but I'm staying in touch.
Plus, I mean, if you actually follow up with me, that probably means something to people these days, don't you find?
I think so, right? Because it shows that you care. enough to give them the phone call.
Yeah. I mean, how much business we've won literally sitting there just saying like how many agents haven't called you back, or how the billion-dollar broker we were talking about earlier, he's like, people will call me and be surprised I pick up my phone. For sure, there's a narrative out there that because of all the social media stuff I do, I'm too busy to actually be working, when in fact, I'm actually working more than almost anybody else because the systems are in place to take care of those other things. So let's talk about that before we wrap this up. Your systems, what systems do you rely on to do your cold calling and kind of manage all the information intake? Because it must just be coming at you.
It is. So I'm very kind of compliant, so to speak. So I have a CRM. I'm going to use my CRM to the fullest. So yeah. I use that for cold calling and record tracking. So all my documents are in there properly sorted. All of my conversations are logged so that I can quickly, they weren't ready 3 months ago, I can quickly go back, look at what they were interested in from maybe a qualification perspective, beds, what have you. And I know that conversation to them is important because I'm calling them, but I'm also prepped with what we spoke about 3 months ago and I can refer to it. Similar to you, Justin, you're underwater basket weaving, absolutely be logged so I can bring it up next time we go.
Yeah, and that's such a key point, right? Anybody that's watching this, if you're taking notes and remembering, people want to be remembered. Another thing Sirhan taught me, right? Like people want to be memorable and they want to be remembered. So if the next time I meet you, you can remember something about me, you're going to build a stronger relationship with me. But if you're calling 250 people a day, I mean, you're a human being. There's no way you can actually intake that much. And literally, like, the basics are what matter in this business, right? We already touched on cold calling. We already talked about actually just putting it into your CRM, because once it's there and you go back, it feels like you have a superpower, right? And Victor Addis is super pumped. Victor Addis is the condo king that Kyle referenced earlier. And he said, sick tips, Kyle. Same thing, right? Victor came in the industry and he's crushing it because he's a relationship guy. But, you know, how do you blend? Let me ask you this question before I get to my rapid fires. Yeah. How do you blend being an empathetic human being, because I know you care about people, with a salesperson? Like, how do you mesh those two and make it a fun experience for all the clients and yourself?
That's a really good question. I think it's definitely achievable for every salesperson. But I just put the transaction in the passenger seat. I think the relationship is the driver, right? I always say this, I think it's on my Instagram somewhere, but I believe in people first, property second. So I'm more interested in you, your family, and the needs of your family. Mm-hmm. And we can find you something that you're looking for. But I think it's more important for me to understand what you're looking for. And if you're a real buyer and you're really interested and you need to move, the transaction will happen when it happens, whether it's now or 6 months from now or 12 months.
Sure.
What do you need? How is this move going to fit your needs? And how can I even just be a part of that entire?
Yeah, I think that's massive. And I love that you said that, because the consumers need to understand that the best relationships you can have are the most transparent ones, right? Where they're telling you their needs, their worries, their concerns. You know, you're not out to just get a quick sale, because, you know, you're doing enough business that you can just give the best advice that you can. And, you know, hey, when it's time to pull the trigger, I'm your guy. I think that's the ultimate goal in sales, right?
For sure.
All right, let's do rapid fire questions. They may not be so rapid fire because some of these questions look like fire. What's one of the greatest lessons you've ever learned?
Hard work pays off for sure.
Consistency, 1% a day forever. That's the game. What are you learning right now?
I'm learning how to balance work and life.
Good luck with that one. There's no work-life balance. You know this. You just find good people that can cover your butt when you're taking time off, right? Yeah. How has failure shaped your life?
Failure is the only thing that shapes life and success, in my opinion. So I'm more focused on my past failures than my future successes, because they are the ones that kind of shaped me to get to those future successes. So I think it's everything in everyone's life.
There's no such thing as failure. I was thinking that earlier today too. Like, people think it's failure for now until they get to the next spot and actually prep them to execute. Who do you know that I should know that maybe I haven't met yet?
My brother, for sure.
Really?
Yeah, 100%. I think you guys are more similar than different, for sure.
That's awesome.
He's a killer.
Yeah, give him a sell. I want to talk to that dude. What have you read that I should read?
I've seen your library. I think we have a lot of the same books, but The Challenger Sale is, I don't know if you've read that.
No, I definitely haven't. Sorry, let me write that one down.
So I actually have. It's a book about how to turn the positives into, or how to turn the negatives into positives, and kind of, it's all about challenging sales and hurdles with difficult customers, difficult clients and how to come out on top.
I'm the most positive guy you'll ever meet. You can shoot me in the leg and we'll probably still have a fun conversation about it after. All right, Kyle, I definitely appreciate your time. I know you got a busy day as well. Everybody go give him a follow. I'll put his notes in the comment. You can connect with Kyle on Instagram. You can connect with him on Clubhouse. But, you know, how can I add value to you? You know, what can I do to serve you or the audience do to serve you in your journey forward here?
Oh, my goodness. But I mean, just saying hi is more than enough. If you're not on my Instagram, come on it and just say hi and let's just chat.
Awesome. If you got any tips from Kyle, please go to his Instagram right now. Send him a DM. Follow him on Clubhouse. He's very active on those forums. He actually does live 60-second games, cold calling, and all kinds of fun stuff in the rooms. We will have him back on the podcast. Appreciate your time, Kyle, and let's get after it.
Thank you so much.
All right. See you, brother.